Good morning, everyone. My name is Mamata Chivakula. I'm the director of Immunohistochemistry Lab and Breast Pathology Services at Mills Peninsula Hospital, which is part of the Sutter Healthcare affiliate, one of the largest health systems in Northern California. My prior work experience includes an associate professor position at McGee Women's Hospital at University of Pittsburgh, where I completed my fellowship, and I was an associate director for Immunohistochemistry Lab at University of Pittsburgh Medical Center. The learning objectives of my talk include to understand the changes in lung cancer testing and treatment happening at a rapid pace, to be educated in the current lung cancer guidelines and recommendations that include the role of immunotherapy and PD-L1 testing, understand the molecular marker testing for ALK, EGFR, ROS1 status in the treatment decision-making, and the role and limitations of next-gen sequencing testing and liquid biopsy testing in lung cancer. Multidisciplinary approach to treatment of lung cancer has been the standard of care to improve the outcomes. One of the most exciting advancements in the lung cancer medicine in recent times is the targeted therapies. Surgery, radiation, chemotherapy, and targeted treatments, as well as immunotherapy alone or in combination, are used to treat lung cancer. Patients' lung tumors that express certain biomarkers such as EGFR, ALK, ROS1 will receive targeted drug alone or in combination with the chemotherapy. Targeted drugs include erlotinib, which is Tarceva, crizotinib, and sertinib, and gefitinib, and et cetera. Immunotherapy has recently emerged as a new treatment option for certain lung cancers. As the treatment of lung cancer is going to be complex, the guidelines emerged to provide tools for the oncologist to choose the appropriate therapy. Numerous recommendations have been added to the updates recently with regards to the molecular diagnostics, and they're included at a very rapid pace. So I'm going to highlight some of the new recommendations that have been added to the guidelines. The new recommendations for molecular testing have been published in 2017 based on the new evidence gathered from the targeted gene and tumor type testing. The key recommendations for 2017 include that the pathologist can use either cell block material or cytology specimens for molecular testing. There is a strong recommendation against EGFR immunohistochemistry testing. Immunohistochemistry, or IHC, has shown to be an alternate methodology for ALK and as well as ROS testing. Alternate gene testing for HER2, RET, BRAF, KRAS, and MET have been included. Testing for EGFR T790M mutations in patients with secondary resistance to EGFR inhibitors has been approved. Role of immunotherapy and PD-L1 immunohistochemistry. This is something evolving very fast, and immunotherapy with anti-PD-1 or the PD-L1 drugs has changed the standard of care in advanced stage cancers such as melanoma, lung cancer, renal cancer, Hodgkin's lymphoma. And we have data that's evolving for other solid tumors as well. Pembrolizumab, which is the Keytruda, FDA approved as first-line therapy in advanced stage non-small cell lung cancers. 45% response rate in tumors with immunohistochemistry expression of greater than or equal to 50% has shown in the tumors. Immunotherapy has reached out to many people through the social media, and also articles have evolved in major newspapers such as the New York Times. There's numerous oncology clinical trials that are emerging looking into the immunotherapy of the PD-L1 responses. And these are called the Keynote clinical trials. You can see how many solid tumors are being tested for the responses for the Keytruda. And all the trials that have been increasing, the active clinical trials are shown on the slide, but as we speak, the number of trials have been increasing at a rapid pace. The PD-1 or the PD-L1 check inhibitors in the normal epithelial cell, the mechanism of the PD-1 or the PD-L1 checkpoint inhibitors has key interest, and it's important for the pathologists and everyone involved in the cancer care to understand the basic mechanism of the PD-1 or the PD-L1 check inhibitor. So in a normal epithelial cell, PD-1 receptor is expressed on the cytotoxic T cells and other immune cells. PD-1 protein is expressed on some macrophages and epithelial cells. The interaction between the PD-1, PD-L1 protects the normal cells against immune recognition by inhibiting the action of cytotoxic T cells. Inactivation of the cytotoxic T cells downregulates the immune response. The inactive T cells are exhausted, ceases to divide, eventually die by the programmed cell death or the apoptosis. On the other hand, in the tumor cells, some carcinoma cells upregulate PD-L1 as mechanism to evade the immune checkpoint. Activate T cells recognize the PD-L1 on cancer cells, similar to that of a normal cell, rendering T cells inactive. The carcinoma cells escape the immune checkpoint inhibition, continue to avoid detection for elimination and proliferation. Biomarkers such as EGFR mutations, ALK and ROS rearrangements predict response rate, which is reported to be up to 70% when the mutations are present. The selective performance of these biomarkers is therefore perceived as excellent. The biology, the therapeutic effect of PD-L1, and the nature of this biomarker testing is completely different. And as the data emerges, we are kind of understanding slowly and steadily. The monoclonal drugs that are out there in the market, including the Keytruda, which is the most popular one, bind to PD-1 on the cytotoxic T cells and prevent the tumor cells that express PD-L1 from binding to the PD-1 receptors on the T cell. This allows for cytotoxic T cells to recognize and kill tumor cells. Here are the PD-1 therapy drugs that are indicated out there in the market. As you can see, the assay and it's a indication either if it's a first line or a second line. And the third row shows that what percent of the PD-L1 expression needs to be reported to show the response rate. And the last column shows that if it can be used as a single agent or along with chemotherapy. As we understand the immunotherapy and PD-L1 immunohistochemistry, there are two terms that have emerged in the pathology immunohistochemistry world for the diagnostic testing. The FDA has introduced the two terms in attempt to regulate the lab-developed tests, which are called the LDTs. So one of the first term is the companion diagnostics. So the companion diagnostics typically mean that it's linked to a specific drug within its approved label, identifies the patients who have significant benefit from the drug. For example, a HER2 testing in breast carcinomas. And if the HER2 is positive, these patients are eligible for the anti-HER2 therapy. Complementary diagnostics are not required for the drug use, provides additional information for physician regarding the use of the drug on which the patients can benefit from the therapy. Here is a table that shows the different PD-1, PD-L1 inhibitors and their FDA status and the clone that's been used and the cutoff points. The PD-L1 immunomarker is just like any other immunohistochemistry marker that we use in the laboratory, which requires pre-analytical issues such as the tissue fixation, handling, and processing, and treatment of sections being prepared for immunohistochemistry that includes the typical antigen retrieval stress that might influence the test outcome. Pathologists who are reading this test must learn what constitutes the true staining or artifact for each particular assay and how to apply any scoring algorithm. Assessment should be carefully controlled, executed, and monitored. The PD-L1 protein expression is reported as either present or absent. It's important to realize that the protein expression is not a continuous variable. It's expressed as absent, low to intermediate to high levels of expression. And the expression of the PD-L1 is shown to be heterogeneous among the tumor cells. Here is a very popular PD-L1 scoring chart that shows how we show a 80% PD-L1 expression and how is it comparable to a 50%, and how do we look at the scoring of the PD-L1. Here's the examples of a negative PD-L1 where it's scored as 0 and positive is 100% and something like a 1 to 50%. One of the earliest trials for Keytruda, which included the KEYNOTE-001 study, has shown that favorable response to pembrolizumab is seen in 50% or greater score cohort, mostly driven by the immunohistochemistry scores, which are well above 50%. The study also observed that the cohort of the patients with tumor proportion score between 1% to 49% had outcomes not statistically different from patients with tumor scoring less than 1%. Predictive power of the PD-L1 immunohistochemistry is not linear across the spectrum of the expression. So for the pathologists in practice, the challenges that we have currently with the PD-L1 immunohistochemistry is that we have four drugs and at least four biomarker clones. Two assays were developed by Dockle based on the 28-8 clone for nivolumab and the 22C3 clone for pembrolizumab or the Keytruda. These tests are validated for use only with Dockle immunohistochemistry autostainer. For Tecentriq and durvalumab, different anti-PD-L1 immunohistochemistry clones, which include SP142, SP263, were developed as biomarker assays by Roche Ventana and can be used only on the Ventana automated immunohistochemistry platforms. In a nice commentary on the Medscape by one of the popular lung oncologists, he has suggested that the key points for successful implementation of PD-L1 in laboratories currently, the most important is the communication as a multidisciplinary team approach. And for pathologists, getting the adequate tissue acquisition, such as cell block material and et cetera. For the PD-L1 immunohistochemistry, one of the important things to keep in mind if you're bringing in the immunohistochemistry clone into the laboratory for testing, the tissue fixation to epitope stability and processing could significantly impact the outcome. And I personally feel that validation is the most important thing as well to be included. PD-L1 immunohistochemistry as a predictive assay for selecting patients for anti-PD-L1 therapy is expected to be very complex. Better understanding of the assay and realistic expectations of its predictive performance need to be established. Heterogeneity of the biomarker confounds its use as a predictive marker. Pathologists and oncology communities still continue to wrestle with the delivery and interpretation of the PD-L1 immunohistochemistry assays for at least this cohort of the patients being considered for these therapies. As the challenges with the PD-L1 immunohistochemistry remain, we have to face another testing, which is the role of the next-gen sequencing or NGS testing for lung cancer. Next-gen sequencing is a multi-gene panel now available for the lung adenocarcinoma patient. NGS includes the MUST genes, which include the EGFR, ALK, ROS1 testing, as well as thousands of genes that are might potentially useful for understanding the cancer biology and the potential therapy. NGS using large targeted gene panels have shown successful performance in small biopsies up to 94% and in the cytology samples up to 100%. NGS testing has also shown high sensitivity in comparison to a single gene testing numerous published studies. NGS technology has demonstrated high potential for detecting gene mutations that can be treated with targeted agents and resistant genes when patients show some resistance to some agents in lung cancers. Limitation to NGS exists, such as inconsistencies between the NGS results and the clinical observations. Additional studies are needed to evaluate large number of mutations observed by NGS for development of effective therapeutic targets. Tumor heterogeneity and detection of low-level mutations have challenged the accurate analysis and reliability of the information archived by the NGS technology. Another important testing that's exciting the oncology world as well as the pathology world is the role of circulating DNA for lung cancer testing. We call this testing as a short term for this is liquid biopsies. The recommendation in the new guidelines state that the use of the liquid biopsies to rule in targetable mutations when tissue is limited or difficult to obtain. Studies have shown that the liquid biopsy methods have high specificity with very low false positive rates, which are less than 5% and can include up to 20%. Due to low sensitivity of the testing, which is only about 60 to 70%, absence of mutations does not exclude the possibility of a mutation. In a very recent published joint review by the College of American Pathologists and the American Association of the Clinical Oncologists found that the significant discordance between the liquid biopsies as well as the tissue results. The study focused on the methodology's interpretation of the liquid testing, found that there is a limited data or evidence currently to support the wide clinical use of the liquid testing. So my final thoughts on the current guidelines and the status of the lung cancer treatment are that new guidelines with evidence-based recommendations offer guidance to pathologists and oncologists in better testing and treating the advanced stage lung cancer patients. The first must test testing includes EGFR, ALK, ROS1 have become the standard of care in advanced lung cancer patients. Next-gen sequencing technology has rapidly advanced and expected to become widely used in clinics as the technology improves, leading to early diagnosis of the non-small cell carcinomas and identification of greater number of the driver genes and potential drug targets in the future. Large studies with data and outcome with NGS testing and results on the outcome in patients with immunotherapy will change further the management of the lung cancer patients in near future.